Good morning. How are you this morning? Well, thank you for being here. Go ahead and open up your bulletins, and we'll just look at a couple of the announcements. If you have an attendance card inside, go ahead and fill that out and drop it in the offering plate as a record of your attendance here today. If you have a kid with you today and you're a visitor with us, on the back of your bulletin, there's a little list of ministries that we have for children. So if you're interested in that, go ahead and take a look at that. There are two retreats coming up, a ladies retreat and a men's advance. If you're interested in those, there's a little information on bullet number two. The men's advance, we're going to have a small informational meeting if you're interested back in the media room following the service. So we're trying to try to start really quickly on that informational meeting. So if you could get back there if you're interested to the media room, we'll give you a little bit of info on that event. Daylight Savings is next Sunday, March the 12th. So if it was fall back, now we have to spring forward, okay? So you're going to spring forward an hour for Daylight Savings this coming Sunday. Young at Heart is on March the 16th at Jumping Catfish in Olathe. We've not been there in a long time. We haven't gone to Jumping Catfish in some time, so I'm excited. So if you're interested in that, the information is there. MOPS is on Thursday, March the 23rd. It's from 8:45 to 11 a.m. And there's a youth rally coming up on March the 24th in Olathe. And the information is there. If you're interested in that and your teenager's not currently a part of the teen group, you can see Mr. Reese. Go ahead and wave your hand. He's up here. So if you're interested in that, you can see him. Also, I'd like to have a small meeting with any of the teenagers and their parents if they're interested in college days following the men's advance meeting. The men's advance thing will only take about 5-10 minutes, so if you could just wait around and we'll meet in the media room as well for the college days if you're interested in that. It's open for kids that are from 9th grade to 12th grade. So if you're interested in that, we'll have a small meeting about that following the men's advance meeting. Thank you very much. Dan, go ahead and lead us in another song.
I always switching stuff up on him because he thinks I'm going to come up here and lead another song. We have our Pastor Pirate kids. They're going to come and sing for us and quote some scripture. And looks like I'm about to get beat. He's got something in his hand there that I don't know what he's going to do with.
Do you think anyone is out there?
It's hard to see anything through all this rain and wind, especially when the ocean waves are as high as mountains.
This is a bad storm, all right. It just keeps going on and on.
Look how dark it is. I don't think I've seen anything look as bad as things do right now.
Just keep shining your light, Ian. There might be a ship out there that needs hope and direction.
Who would be foolish enough to go out in this storm? I think I am going in for a nice long nap.
Hold on, kid. Caleb, I think I see something. Yes, it's a ship, and it's in trouble. Shine your light over there, Ian.
I see them now. Sound the alarm, Caleb. We're going to need reinforcements.
There they are, millions upon millions of lost souls. Who will shine the light of God's word to guide them into the safety of God's kingdom? Shine the light. The
Romans 1:16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. To everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek.
Lost and dying, full of woe. But will they ever know if nobody will go to tell them Jesus died to pay the cost? He died upon the cross to rescue sinners lost.
Shine the light of Jesus.
many sink in selfish worldly ways. By Satan they're deceived, refusing to believe. So Christians share the news that Jesus saves, that we must turn from sin, holding fast to Him.
Sound an SOS, we must warn the sinful souls of men. They are lost souls and drowning in their sin. Christians, shine the light of Jesus from the lighthouse of God's Word, and toss the gospel lifeline to the world. Toss the gospel lifeline to the world. Toss the gospel
seated. As you're doing so, grab your Bibles if you would, please. I do have just a small story to tell you. Last Sunday, our youngest daughter, Tabitha, she's running a fever between 104, 105. And so we left, she's seven, so we left her home all by herself to take care of her. No, my wife stayed with her. And all the mothers are like, "You did what?" Sarah stayed home with her, and Sarah got the laptop and pulled it up and turned the service on. And Sarah told me later on that in the middle of the song service, since this is the only mic, you know where I'm going with this. You can. I haven't even told you yet, and you're already laughing at me. And she goes, "Mom, isn't there anybody else singing but Dad?" Sorry, Tabby, you have to listen to me. Maybe one of these days we'll get some boom mics hung out over here, and you guys can join me on singing my solos on Sunday morning. James chapter 2 this morning. I guess I didn't tell you where to turn in your Bibles yet. Sorry about that. James chapter 2. I was talking to the pastor this morning. He said, "We've got to get this right." So I've read this a couple times this morning, so hopefully I don't mess it up or mess anybody up. This is talking about faith and works. And James addresses this issue quite straightforward. It can be somewhat confusing, but if we take our time, I'm going to let the pastor do this, take it, pick it apart, explain it. We'll just read through it right now, and he'll come here in just a moment and go through it. James chapter 4, we'll start, sorry, James chapter 2, start at verse 14, and we will go through the end of the chapter. James chapter 2, verse number 14. "What doth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and have not works, can faith save him? If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, Depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled, notwithstanding you give them not those things which we are needful to the body, what doth it profit? Even so faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. Yea, a man may say, Thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by my works. Thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seeing thou hast faith, wrought with his works, and by works was faith made perfect. And the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. You see then how that by works a man is justified, and not by faith only. Likewise also, was not Rahab the harlot justified by works, when she had received the messengers and sent them out another way? For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also." Just before the pastor comes this morning, 781, face to face, we'll sing the first and last verse only. 781. Face to face with Christ.
Is it all His glory? All right, very good. Good morning, everybody. Good to see you all. I did get the thank you card here as well. You know, Cheryl and her family have really gone through a lot in the last couple weeks. They lost a niece that was 32 years of age, and so I wanted to read their thank you letter to the church. And it's from the Wrights, the Cherries, and the McGees. They would like to say thanks for all the love and support that our church family poured out to us. God's love through all of you really came through. And thanks to all who helped with the funeral dinner afterward. It was much appreciated. We love you all. Thanks for being there for us in a difficult time. So they do want to say thank you to all of you for that. And I appreciate that as well. And we continue to pray for Roger and Sue now that everybody's gone and they have to wake up every morning with this. Now is when they need the grace of God as much as ever, really. So be praying for that family, if you would. I try to keep them in my prayer list as well, and that God would begin to heal and help as they go through this time in their life. I do want to welcome you all to Lighthouse Baptist Church. It is great to have you today. I do look forward to, almost with a little bit of fear and trembling, I guess, but James chapter 2 is a very important passage of Scripture, and for some, it's a little controversial. Some people look at it maybe a little different way, and I understand that, but we want to try to delve into the Word of God and try to be honest with it to the best of our ability and let God lead us, and I think that if we do that, we'll be okay. So be very good. I do want to welcome all of you here to church, and as well as the good church in Bible Baptist Church in Bonner Springs. We appreciate them being here as well, and please keep them in your prayers, and we love them and appreciate them. Got a lot of good people there, and so we are praying for them as well, for God's will and for His direction in their lives. Well, if you're at James chapter 2, we're going to delve right in, but we begin usually with a word of prayer, and I'd like to do that this morning. Heavenly Father, as we think about opening up your word and looking at what you have to say, we just want to say, Father, would you teach us today? Help us, Father, to understand what this author of James is trying to teach us out of James chapter 2, and I pray, Lord, that we would be submissive to it. I pray, Father, that we would go in the right direction. And most of all, I pray that you would help us to realize or understand whether or not our faith is real. And so, Father, I don't want to scare anyone to thinking that they're lost when they're really saved, but I do pray that you would help us to think about the direction of our life and how that, as we look at the direction of our life, it can authenticate or confirm whether or not our faith is real or not. And so help us to understand that this is what you're teaching through the book of James. In Jesus' name I pray, Lord, for your direction. Amen. All right. James chapter 2 begins, if we were to look at the first three verses, which we've not read yet, but I'd like to divert your attention to the first three verses for just a moment. It really deals with how a real child of God should act, should think, and should believe. And so what this deals with quite a bit is the authenticity of our faith that's inside of us. And he begins with a very simple and yet poignant and very apropos illustration, example for us even today. We all have this situation come in our lives occasionally. And begins with an illustration. And if we were to start in verse number 1, it says, "My brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect of persons." What does that mean? Well, keep reading. "For if there come into your assembly a man with a gold ring in goodly apparel, and there come in also a poor man in vile raiment," rags, not too much going on there, "and ye have respect to him that weareth the gay clothing," and that means something different in our text than it does today, but, in the fancy clothes, "and saying to him, oh, please come and sit right here. Sit thou here in a good place." And then you look at the poor person in the rags and you say, would you mind just standing over there or sit here under my footstool, sit in this place where you're not going to get in the way. You notice the two different ways that the person treats them. And it all depends on whether or not they're fancy and rich, or whether or not they're poor and beggarly and somebody of no means whatsoever to repay. I would like for you to notice that he's saying in verse number one, he says, my brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect of persons. So essentially what he's saying is, please, don't let anyone know that you're a Christian, or don't even think that you are a Christian and along with that, have respect of persons or show partiality to people that you think are fancy, and then you disrespect those who don't. He says, don't let that be, that's a bad testimony for Christianity. Don't let anyone know that you even know anything about Christ. Don't even let others think that you are a Christian if you're going to have in one hand Christianity and in the other hand you're carrying the filthy bucket of partiality. He said, don't do that because they are not the same. And so he's right. And he gives kind of an interesting illustration of this. And we can look at that in a biblical term and we can pass right over it, or we can say, what goes through my mind? What happens to me when I meet a CEO or somebody that's extremely wealthy, well-to-do, successful? What goes through my mind? Do I get uncomfortable? Or are you the type of person that gets very comfortable around that kind of a person? And you put on your best face and you put on all your hospitality and you try to rise up to their standard and you kind of sit up a little straighter and you make sure your hair's in the right place. We're all susceptible to various thoughts within us when we meet a rich person. If we're just to be honest. And by the way, we have also certain thoughts that go through our mind, certain feelings that go through our heart when we meet a poor person as well. We do. We have a reaction within us. We don't let it, most of the time, we don't try to publicize those reactions, but they are very real inside of us. And so I don't know too many super wealthy people, but in my life I've met a couple, and I know that I'm susceptible to that as well. I get this inferiority complex like nobody's business when I'm around really fancy, well-to-do people. And so so we have to be very cautious. Somewhere deep down inside of all of us, when we meet somebody that is poor and is a poor person, he can stir up thoughts. And so when you see somebody come through the door that you know is homeless, let's say, and doesn't smell quite right, or has a person that is poor and has desperate needs, certain thoughts begin to come up, especially if we are just meeting them for the first time. Sometimes our initial response is interest and like, can we help? But the more you get around people that are really poor and really needy is, hey, I need to be cautious because they're going to ask something of me. They're going to turn to me and they're going to say, hey, can you help me? And do you know of anyone that could help me with this? Can you help me with that? And so in many of us, somewhere deep down, we don't like to talk about it. We don't like to show others these thoughts. But there is a cautiousness that comes over us that, hey, this person might need something from me. And so sometimes there is a distance. We take a small step backward a little bit. Let there be a little bit of distance because this might be the kind of person who's going to constantly ask me for favors of some kind. And so I can show Christian concern, but I don't want to get too close because they're going to get me so involved and they're going to get me neck deep in these things. Now, we would never say these things out loud. They're way down deep inside of us, but I'm just saying that we're capable of having certain thoughts and reactions go through us when we meet somebody that is super poor or have extreme needs in their life. Sometimes there is a defensive mechanism that does come up. We're capable of it. And same thing happens when a rich person comes in the room. I mean, they're dressed to the nines. Is that what they call it? Dressed to the nines? I don't know why they call it that. They have the fancy, and the scripture he's talking about, the gold ring. You're talking about everything is pressed. If I were to take my shirt down, it's not ironed too good, so I try to cover up. I'm going to button up right now. Now I'm conscientious of that. But no, their shirt is pressed. Everything is just right. They smell tremendous. And you begin to think, oh, hi, how are you doing? You know, and we put our A game on as this guy's really impressive. You find out that this person's really talented. You find out that this person's really successful. This person is strong and God seems to have it all going. And it feels good to be around that person. If he or she befriends you and this guy, seems to like me a lot and everything, and he wants to hang out and become buddies and that kind of thing. Man, it feels pretty good going down the road and hanging out with this guy and to be seen with this very successful person. It makes me feel special. And so we're kind of inappropriately drawn to be around people like that because of how it could help me. All of a sudden, now I'm the needy person, and maybe if I fall on hard times, if this guy's my best friend, you know, maybe he could help me out. Or if I come to a place where I need a job, maybe he knows somebody who could hook me up with that. And so I kind of like being around this particular kind of person, and I'm very polite, and I'm very giving, and I'm very nice, and I'm super uber kind to this particular person. And so what a great opportunity to be friends with this person. What a great contact to know someone like that. And maybe, just maybe, if I hang around with this super successful person, maybe in some ways I could be successful too. And so down deep within us, if we meet somebody like that and they're drawn to us, we kind of like it. And so there's no inhibitions. We're saying, hey, if you want to be my friend, I'll be your friend. Because it could really help me as well. I'm just saying that we're capable of these kinds of thoughts. And if we were to fall for those kinds of thoughts, and that would be our motivation to be drawn to the rich or to be repelled from the poor, these kinds of motivations are, according to James chapter 2, these are improper for the Christian. It is incongruent with a person who says they have a belief in Jesus Christ. And so the Apostle James here, he says that it is improper. If that is your sole motivation for being nice or friendly, it's a pretty bad reason to buddy up with somebody. And actually, these thoughts are improper. And not only that, can I just say it goes on further than that. James says that these thoughts are wrong to prefer the rich guy and then to snub the poor guy. And in verse number 4, he says that's not the way Christianity should be. Look at verse 4. Are ye not then partial in yourselves and become judges of evil thoughts? Wow. And so he says, you are on the wrong path. This is not how Christ wants children to live. We are to have better motives than that. We are to think differently than that. Actually, God wants us to be more externally focused rather than internally. We shouldn't do things for our own motivation. We should do things for God's motivation. So we should be helping others, not being thinking about being helped. And getting, we should be more in tune with giving. And so he says we are to live differently than that, and certainly no preferential treatment should come from somebody who has a belief in Christ and says that they are a Christian. And as a matter of fact, we only have true faith when we live and think much differently than that, and it calls into question. So our faith, our belief in Christ, yes, I'm talking about the moment when you got saved, you placed your faith and trust in Christ, you asked him to forgive you of your sins, you asked him to come into your heart and to be your Lord and Savior, and that belief and that trust that that you had at that moment, it is all called into question if you are prone to being a person of partial, if you're being partial in your dealings with humankind. So yes, your vertical relationship with Christ comes into question when your horizontal relationship with the poor or the rich are for the wrong reasons. And so everything is really called into question. And so true faith, when it's real, when Christ really is living within us, it changes our behavior and helps us to avoid those kind of things. And if we do go into those directions, we're at least convicted about it, and we repent of those things, and then we get away from it. We don't give way to that. So it changes our behavior into godly behavior. It changes our thinking into loving thinking, helpful thinking. It changes our motives into pure motives and not ulterior, selfish, self-preservationist type of thinking, right? And motives. So and so here's what we end up with. We end up talking about, we start talking about a poor guy or a rich guy coming in here and how we treat him, and we end up talking about whether or not our faith is real or our faith is fake. You know, fake faith. And so to identify those things, and this relationship, this interesting little example, helps us to get on that particular topic as well. Fake faith talks a good game. They know all the language. They know how to say Jesus Christ and Lord and Savior. They know how to say all of these things. But fake faith still holds onto the same selfish thoughts and motives that the old man used to have, and so and is not inhibited about living in that lane. So here's an example of fake faith. Verse number 14 in our text. So now we skip all the way down to verse number 14. And he continues with this thought of the poor man and the rich man. Okay? So here's an example of fake faith. If you have a poor brother who knocks on your door and he's needing something. He needs food or clothing or shelter or whatever. He needs help. And we are not moved in our heart and mind by this need and the idea of, hey, yes, I will help you. I can see that you're in desperate need. But instead, we respond with, oh, brother, here he comes again. He's asking again. I can't believe it. And so, we say, yes, I have the food. Yes, I have the clothes that maybe you need. But I'm sorry, I just can't help you today. God bless you. I hope you find what you need. You know, you're nice about it, but no. The answer is no, I can't help you with that. When we respond by with that, James says, what good is your faith? What if you respond to your brother like that, then what good is your horizontal relationship with Christ? It's worthless, is what he says. Look at verse number 14. He starts it off. What doth it profit? In other words, what good is it, man, my brethren? Though a man say he have faith and not works, can faith save him? If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled. Oh, that sounds very nice, but there's no food that goes along with it. Notwithstanding, ye give them not those things which are needful to the body. What doth it profit? What good is it if you've done that? It's no good whatsoever. And so, isn't it an amazing thing that all of it, I mean, the whole enchilada is called it, the enchilada being salvation, eternal life. The whole enchilada is called into question by how you treat somebody. Maybe you're not saved at all. Maybe you don't have Christ inside of you at all. If you can, with a good conscience, treat a rich person and buddy up to him for your own ulterior motives, or you look at the needy and it doesn't even cross your mind, hey, I don't even want to do that. I don't even want to help that person. They have to have help all the time. Somebody else can help them when it's within your ability to help them. The whole enchilada is called into question. Your salvation may not be real. Actually, what doth it profit? What good is it? And so everything, salvation, forgiveness, redemption, justification, sanctification, all of these are tied up in how we behave and specifically in this example, how we treat people. God says, what good is your faith? It's worthless. You know what it kind of reminds me a little bit of? There's a, and Paul, and I'll get into this a little bit, but because Paul's big on salvation is by faith alone, no works. And so we'll clarify that in just a little bit. But Paul also wrote 1 Corinthians 13. Is that what drew your mind to that too? As I was studying that, I'm going, man, this reminds me a lot of 1 Corinthians 13. Because you can have all of the language, you can have all the dress suits, you can have everything in line, but if you don't have charity, you have nothing. Isn't that what it says? Though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I can remove mountains, have not charity, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not charity, if I'm doing all of these things and I don't have love inside of me, it's all for nothing. It profiteth me nothing. So it reminds me a lot of that. And so what good is your faith if you're not willing to live this faith and let Christ, the love of Christ, live out within you? If you're not able to do that, then you need to call in question the authenticity of your faith. You say, well, what good is it? And that's what James says. Well, what doth it profit you to have this salvation if you're not changing into the image of Christ? Well, here some might respond and say, well, here's what it's going to help. My faith keeps me out of hell, keeps me out of the hot place so that I can go to heaven one day. That's what good it does to me. Who cares if I don't treat somebody decent occasionally or if I have ulterior motives on occasion? If I believe in Jesus, then I am saved. I'm good. I'm good for all of eternity. You see, that's your singular, narrow perspective. That's your internal, narrow perspective. But God has a perspective on this as well. And His perspective is, says, I want you to believe in me for salvation, and then I want you to become like me. I want you to, in turn, after you believe in me and after I give you salvation, I want you to become the salt of the earth. You see, the world needs you to become like me so that they can see me in you. I want you to be the light of the world. I want you to be the salt of the world. I want you to spread my love and kindness. I want all the world to see how we love each other so that they'll know that you're my disciples. See? And that's my plan. So if your plan is, I'm just going to say a little verse, I'm going to say a little couple sentences, and then I'm good for eternity, and whether or not I change or don't change, it's irrelevant. God says, that's your perspective. My perspective is, it's very relevant. And the reality and the confirmation of what you call belief in me is called totally into question if you're not willing to change, if you're not willing to become my servant. Then I wonder if you truly believe in me, like I mean, do you believe in me? So, he didn't make you his child so that you can act any way that you want. The idea is he wants to make you his child so that we could act and think and react like him. And that's his desire. So you might ask, well, what does my kindness or love or motives have to do with believing in Jesus for salvation? And God answers this passage, this question, by saying it has everything to do with it. Look at verse 17. Even so, faith, if it hath not works, if it doesn't follow through and change you, if faith has not works, it's dead. That's what it says. Being alone, it's just dead. Translation, your faith isn't real. It's not real. Real faith changes your life, your actions, your thoughts, and your motivations. So you can say all day long that you have faith, that you believe in Jesus, but if you don't change your conduct, if something's not constantly changing inside of you, if you can do wrong and have no conviction about it whatsoever, if you don't care about the needy, if you don't do what pleases the God that you say you believe in, then your faith is not real. James says, let's talk about the validity of your faith by looking at your life and what you do. And then I'll show you my faith by my works. He says, I believe, and I'll show you this way. Now, James, who wrote the book of James? A guy named James. There's three Jameses that we know of in the New Testament. Taken out the Apostle James, and I might have misspoke earlier because I'm not talking about one of the 12 disciples. He's not that guy, because he died in AD 44. This was written about a couple decades after that, actually. So we know he's out, because he was one of the first guys to die a martyr's death. I mean, I know Stephen was, but James was pretty early on as well. There's no way, Bible historians tell us, there's no way he wrote the book of James. Another guy, we're not 100% sure a whole lot about him, but there's another James that keeps coming up, and that's the half-brother of Jesus. So it is the accepted opinion of most Bible theologians that the half-brother of Jesus wrote the book of James. So James could have said, hey, I believe, I'm going to tell you something, I believe, this was my half-brother, I'm telling you, I grew up with this guy, I believe. I was there when he showed himself as risen again, I believe. And that could be the point of view that he comes from. He could also say, and I believe it's true, I was there when he ascended. I mean, he spoke those last words, and then all of a sudden he went up into the sky, and I saw the ascension. I believe. He could go at it from a few different points that are very powerful and very dramatic. But he says, I'm not going to tell you that my faith is valid because I was the half-brother of Jesus, or I saw him alive after he was dead, or that I saw him ascend. He says, I'll show you my faith by my works. Look at verse 18. Yea, a man may say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works. And he says, I will show thee my faith by my works. I'll show you the validity of what's beating inside my heart, that my belief in Christ is real, by the way that my life has changed. And boy, oh boy, did James' life change, especially after the resurrection, because what he once was a scoffer of Jesus, and now he's a believer in Christ. As a matter of fact, he ended up being a martyr for his half-brother as well. And so we know that the faith of James is really true by the way he lived his life. I will show thee my faith by my works. Some might say, they might pause, and many have, by the way. They say, wait a minute, hold the bus right here. Stop the train, pull the cord, wait a minute. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I have this belief in him. Well, James says, I was waiting for you to say that, because so do the demons. They have this, look at verse 19. Thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? It doesn't matter if you believe in this description of this Jesus or not, if it's not real within you. Is there a disagreement? So some people really struggle with this passage, so I want to clarify two things at this moment, okay? Number one, is there a disagreement between the Apostle Paul's writing and James' writing, the half-brother of Jesus? And I want to tell you today, there is no disagreement in their doctrine at all. They do not disagree. And you say, well, if you were to look at some of the writings of the Apostle Paul, he writes, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. He goes on and speaks of salvation in Romans 11, verse 6, and he hits it really hard. He says, we're saved by grace through faith. If it's of grace, then it's no more of works, he says in verse number 6. Otherwise, grace is no more grace, but if it be of works, then it is no more of grace. Otherwise, work is no more work. He goes on in other passages and says, hey, if Abraham was saved by what he did, then God owed it to him, owed salvation to him. And if we're saved by works, then it's a debt that God owes us, because you did the work, he has to pay you for that through salvation. So if salvation is by grace or through works, it's no more of grace, because you're working for it and you're earning a paycheck, and the paycheck is salvation. That's the Apostle Paul's message to a group of people in Ephesians and Romans and other passages. And I just want to reiterate, there is no disagreement. James would agree with that 100% completely. They are not at odds with one another. They are simply dealing with different doctrinal issues. different doctrinal problems that they were, who was Paul dealing with? He was dealing with Judaizers who would come into the Baptist church and they would say, oh, wow, it's good to see all of you Christians here today, and I'm a Christian too, and it's good to believe in Christ, but we do need to make sure that if you have a baby boy, that he has to be circumcised because we have to do that too. These are called Judaizers, and they want to drag the law in with grace, and that is wrong. And James would tell you today, that is wrong. You don't add works to be able to get salvation. You don't add works to it, right? And so that was his point of view. James' message and what he's dealing with is totally different. James is simply saying that the works of love, the evidence of salvation, should be seen in your life. And if it's not, your faith isn't real. So he's talking about confirming the validity of your salvation. Salvation is still without works. You don't work for it. It is a gift of God given to us by placing our faith in him. But the question is that when we call, I believe in Christ, is it the same belief that God's talking about? The kind of belief that God's talking about is the kind of belief that once it resonates within us, it begins to change us. And so James is dealing with people that claim to be a follower of Christ, but they are partial towards the poor and towards the rich. They still have the same attitude. They still have the same motives as a lost man. And then he's just simply saying it's not real. It's not that you have to add works to make salvation. It's just if you want to find out, is my salvation real or not, then look to see if anything's changed in your life. And that's a totally different message. So James is talking about the confirmation, the validity of your profession of faith. And so I just want to say, salvation is still a one-step process. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. It's still very much, and James is in total agreement with that as well. The question is what does it mean to believe? We have to be on the same page with John 3:16 when it says, for whosoever believeth on him, what does that mean? And so James says, let me help you with that. Let me give you an illustration. I'll give you two, actually. One is Abraham. He truly believed that he would inherit a nation, that God would give him a child. When he was 75, he was promised that. And even in Bible days, that's getting up there for having babies, okay? Just ask Sarah. She'll tell you, I'm not going to have a baby when I'm 75. So even back then, that was something else. But you know what? Abraham believed it. And then when finally God gave him a child, and we know how that Isaac was born, beautiful, wonderful. It was 99 years old. Abraham was knocking on the door of 100 years old, and Sarah was pretty old herself, I think in her 90s. Gave him. And then all of a sudden God came to Abraham one day, and he said, hey, you love that son, don't you? You love Isaac, don't you? Well, it was a long road getting to that, having that boy that promised to be the nation as the sand of the sea, stars of the sky, and I'm going to bless, and you are the father. You're the patriarch, Abraham, and it's all going to start here, and good things are going to happen. You love that boy, don't you? Oh, I love that boy. Man, you're not kidding. Well, I have a request of you. I'd like for you to go, and I'd like for you to sacrifice him on the altar to me. Would you do that for me? Now, this is not something, this is totally out of context of what God ever asked. God never asked anyone else to ever sacrifice their son upon an altar. But I'll tell you what, when Abraham got the wood together, and he got his son, and he brought the knife on that trip, and they took that trip up into the mountains, and he built that altar. And Isaac looked at his father, and he says, where's the sacrifice? And Abraham said, the Lord will provide. And little did he know, he was going to be the sacrifice. And God let him go all the way to the point where he had the knife over his head, and he would have sacrificed his son. And then God said, wait a minute, now I know that the belief you say you believe in me is really true. And you believe in me with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. The passage in our text speaks of Abraham. Look at it, verse 21. Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? And so he was commanded to do that. He took his son, he took the wood, he took the knife, he went up into the mountain, he built the altar, he raised the knife over his head. Genesis 22, verse 9 says, and they came to the place which God had told him of, and Abraham built an altar there, laid the wood in order, bound Isaac his son, laid him on the altar of the wood, and Abraham stretched forth his hand and took the knife to slay his son. And then, of course, we know the story. God stopped. And he says, now I know. You say you believe? He really believed. And he was willing to have given it all. The scripture was fulfilled, which saith, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness. Verse 23, and he was called the friend of God. And so he really believed. So when John 3:16 says, for whosoever believeth in him, this is the kind of belief we're talking about, where it is all in. Rahab was all in as well. It's another great story of a woman who helped the Israelite army. And she knew that the Lord was with this army. She knew that this was the true God. And so she helped the two spies to be able to get away. Verse 25 in our text speaks of Rahab the harlot, justified by works when she had received the messengers and had sent them out another way. So here's what these two have in common. They were all in, Rahab and Abraham. They were all in. Their belief led them to utter surrender of every part of their lives, and they were completely and all in. And so somebody might say, well, I believe in Jesus. I believe that he was this historical. I've come to grips. I believe that he was a historical figure. I believe that he died on a cross. I believe that he was the Son of God. And so we have all of these things where we use this word, and it becomes semantics, doesn't it? We use this word, I believe, in this historical figure, and I even believe that he was the Son of God. Congratulations, you've just pulled into the same lane and you're at the same place as the demons, right? Isn't that what verse 19 says? He says, congratulations, the demons believe. Oh, and they fear and they tremble. They know that that there is one God that verse 19 talks about. They also know that Jesus was the Son of God. We know from a passage in Matthew. Actually, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John have the same story, how that they said, Jesus, thou Son of God, have you come to? And they were quaking and fearful at that particular moment. And so they were very afraid. They too believe. So you've pulled into the same lane as them. There's a syllogism when talking about this this particular text that's kind of interesting, and it's helpful, I believe. The syllogism goes like this. And you know what a syllogism is. It's you make a couple of points, and then you make a conclusion from those points. When I was in school, the syllogism was love is blind. Oh, man, I can't remember the syllogism. It's been too long. I'm sorry about that. It's totally gone from me. But anyway, here's the syllogism. Couple points, then a conclusion. Anyone who believes in God is saved. Anyone who believes in God is saved. Point one. Point two, demons are not saved. Conclusion, demons do not believe in Jesus. And so we can see the conflict in this. And so we look at this way of thinking. Anyone who believes in Jesus is saved. Demons are not saved. Therefore, demons don't believe in Jesus. And so the problem with this belief is that what we're talking about is the difference between a head knowledge and a heart knowledge. We're talking about cognizant recognition. It's a distant, impersonal understanding of a certain truth. We know that that's not what it means when it says, for whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That belief, whosoever believeth in him, means much more than a cognizant recognition that this historical figure was this and did this. It's more than that. When we believe, we're all in. Just like Abraham was all in. He was willing to give everything. Rahab, the biggest move in her entire life, she was all in. She could have been killed for what she did. She was all in. It brings to mind that wonderful illustration of the guy, which I guess is a true story, who would take the tightrope over Niagara Falls. They would cinch it down, and then he would go back and forth over, and they had big crowds all around. And then he would take a wheelbarrow, and he'd go back and forth and everything. And then he would go to the crowd, and he'd really play him up, and he would say, "How many of you believe that I can make it across with in this wheelbarrow?" And everybody, "Oh, yes, I believe, that's true." "How many of you believe that if I had a person inside the wheelbarrow, that I could make it across?" "Oh, yes, we believe." And he'd get a lot of hands. He goes, "Okay, who wants to volunteer?" You know, and I love that story because that, and so we're talking about two different beliefs here. We're talking about one that is willing to give all, and that's the salvation belief, where we truly believe the way God intended it to be. And I had a lunch a number of months ago with Shirley, Jim and Shirley. Now, Jim, I think, was a ranger, and he has jumped out of a lot of airplanes in his lifetime, and that's one of the things that he did. And when Shirley turned 76 on her 76th birthday, she surprised Jim, and she walked in and said, "Jim," she goes, "I want to jump out of an airplane for my 76th birthday." He goes, "What?" And it just kind of came out of nowhere. And she goes, "I do. I want to do that. And so if you would arrange that for me, find a good place, and I want to get up in an airplane, and I want to jump out, and I want to do that for my 76th birthday." When she told me that, I just laughed and laughed. It just is so amazing. But you know what? As she was up there in that plane, if you can just imagine Shirley up there with her goggles on, and she's kind of tethered to this other guy because she was doing a tandem jump, and he was telling her, you know, "We're getting close to her," and then the door opens up, and the wind's blowing all around and everything, and for her to, when he says, 1, 2, 3, jump, you know, for her to say, "Okay." See, you're all in then. You believed that the parachute would open. You believed that you would be okay. You believed that everything would work this way, and you had a belief in that, and you were willing to give everything to that, you see? And so that's the kind of belief that God is. It's so real that you hold nothing back from God. It's so real that it affects who you are and what you want to be in your life. You want to be pleasing. You want to be do and think and act like the Father that saved you. And yes, it deals with everything, and it even affects how you treat people. You want to treat people like God wants you to treat people. And so we go away from, or we try to stay away from, being partial to the rich and be distant from the poor. But instead, we open up our hearts and minds to that because our faith, our vertical faith in God is real. It affects how we treat one another. We do need to know that if we are on the right track. I get this all the time, honestly. It's a question that is in our many people's minds, and they ask me this all the time. I don't know if I'm really saved. I don't know if, am I okay? I mean, is this all that I have to do? And is it real in my life? And I'll tell you what, when we talk about do you really believe, we're going to talk about to what extent do you believe? Are you willing to give everything? Have you given Him everything? All to Jesus I surrender. All to Him I freely give. And it would be terrible to go to church all of your life and you think, "Well, I'm okay. I think I'm okay." And really not be in your life. It'd be terrible to go through your entire life and think that you're on your way to heaven when in truth you are not. The question in your heart should be, as I look at and I ask myself the question, is my faith real or not? The question is are you wanting to please God in every area of your life? Have you surrendered everything to Him? Do you want to slowly but surely become more and more like Him? Are you going to fall? Are you going to fail? Yeah, you're going to fail, but ever increasingly becoming more like Christ. If that is your goal, then that's a good sign that what's inside of you is real and true and authentic. And so let's take the message from James. Search our hearts. If there's no inner changes going on, then I say make sure of your salvation, because faith without works is dead. Verse 26 in our text, "But as the body without the Spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead as well. It is empty." And if you do understand that we are to spend our lives surrendering to God's plan, then stay in the Word. Say, God, teach me today. As I read my Bible today, teach me something that you want me to do or think or believe, and so that I can change, and help me to stay humble and teachable and moldable. Let me stay away from the lust of my flesh and just wanting to use people. And let me listen to God's voice and how he wants me to treat people. Let's keep praying for righteousness. Keep praying for wisdom. Keep praying for strength. Keep praying that God would help you become the child he wants you to be, the man that he wants you to be, the woman that he wants you to be. And we will ever increasingly grow in our faith and in our surrender to him. And we will know that our faith is real and it's true within us. Amen? Amen. Let's all stand. Heavenly Father, it's been good to be in your word this morning. Thank you, Lord, for that. Thank you, Father, for helping us to understand this perspective, that if our faith is real, it should change us within. And so I pray, Lord, that you would know that we do believe in you. We do trust in you. And I pray, Lord, that we'd be able to show our faith by how you are changing us in our heart, by how we act and what we do and what we think. Help us, Father, to be pure in our motives. Help us, Lord, to be steadfast and true and determined to surrender to you and to be pleasing in your sight. All I want is to be pleasing in the sight of my Savior. Oh, Father in heaven, help us to realize this is the need of the hour. And Father in heaven, this does wonderful things in validating the faith that's inside of us. In the name of Jesus Christ, I ask these things. Amen. Amen. All to Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give. As your heads are bowed and eyes are closed this morning, I just want to ask you the question, have you seen any changes in your heart, in your life? Do you struggle with any changes? And you say, oh, there's nothing, and I don't understand that. I want you to talk to yourself and look deep within you to find out, do you truly believe in Jesus? Have you trusted him to a point where you've given everything? Have you had that conversation with him? I give you all of my life. I withhold nothing. Nothing is in reserve. I totally surrender into you because I truly believe that you are the Savior of the world. I truly believe that your way is the right way. Have you surrendered completely to him, to salvation? And if you've not, I pray that today would be the day where you give him everything and you'd start this quest, this journey of trusting in Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. And let it be beautiful, that relationship with him, let it be beautiful, but it also may it be reflective as you then begin to deal with your family, your friends, your neighbors, and let them see that there's a change within you, a change that leads to kindness and love and trust in your Savior. I also pray that God would help us to realize that this is an ever increasing quest that we are on. You're not perfect today, but may God help you to realize he doesn't care about your goals and your dreams and your ambitions. He has dreams and ambitions for you, and may his dreams and ambitions and his plan for your life be the thing that truly matters. As you sing the song to the Lord, make sure it's to the Lord. All to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. All means all. Amen. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him, in his presence daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all. Sing another verse. All to Jesus I surrender, humbly at his feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me. Savior, I surrender all. Oh, Oh, Father in heaven, thank you, Lord, so much for the day that you've given. I pray that you would bless this these verses that we've gone over. And I pray, Lord, that you would authenticate in all of our hearts and minds the faith that we have in you. And I pray, Lord, that this is a group of folks, that there's not one person in this room that has not dedicated their heart and life to you, that they've not believed in you with all of their heart, their soul, and their mind, and now they want to live for you. And I pray, Lord, that you would help each one come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Because thank you, Lord, that we can have a know-so salvation. I know it. I know it. I know it because of what lives within me, because my want-tos have changed, and because he controls my every care. So, Father, and I pray that you would bless this these verses. And maybe there might be some that would meditate this week on these verses and just kind of go over them again. And I pray, Lord, that you'd continually speak to us. And we thank you, Lord, for this teaching. I pray, Lord, that you would dismiss us here safely. In the name of Jesus Christ, we ask these things. Amen. I do want to remind all those who are deacons and trustees that tonight at about 5 o'clock, 5:15, we do have a meeting back in the room. So God bless you guys for that. You have one more?
Also, if you're interested in the men's advance, if any age, from a child to an elderly man, if you're interested in that, we're going to have a meeting back there in the media room right after service. And then directly after that, we'll have an informational meeting about college days. If you have a teen that's interested, parents are welcome. If you want to get some information, it'll be on the 15th through the 17th, and we'll have a meeting directly after the men's advance meeting. All right, thank you very much. You're dismissed.